Hey Nintendo fans, it's TheJWittz here, and welcome to the latest Pokémon video. Now for a long time, you guys have really enjoyed my videos, especially the ones where I talk about things that I don't like. Well, today is the Holy Grail, because we're talking about my least favorite Pokémon games ever. Let's check it out.
Today, I want to go over a handful of Pokémon games that have left a bad taste in my mouth one way or another. This is by no means a complete list. I'm not touching the main series games, because I like them all. I'm also not touching fan-made games or demos. I'm also ignoring the Pokémon box-based titles because they just exist for extra storage. No, in general, I want to use today to talk about real games that you could put real money towards, only to be pretty disappointed. Let's jump in, starting with some eShop titles before we get into the big stuff. First up is Pokémon Rumble U. But TheJWittz, you might ask, isn't there a Let's Play of Pokémon Rumble U buried deep in this channel? Yes, there is, but even there you'll find lots of my complaints throughout the video as I go through it. The first Pokémon Rumble is really fun for the $20 WiiWare game that it was. It played like an extremely light version of Diablo, with all kinds of Pokémon to collect with special abilities and even shiny variants. It was co-op, easy to play, and fun. The 3DS version was alright. It didn't have shiny Pokémon, and it was a little less of a value being a full-price 3DS game, but it had a cute story mode and some Street Pass functionality. The Wii U version of Rumble just feels weak. Instead of moving stages, every battle in Rumble U is restricted to a small arena. Special ability and shiny Pokémon are restricted to download code Pokémon only, and the NFC scannable figures. Oh yeah. Rumble U's major mechanic, or so you'd think, is using lots of Skylander-like figures with saveable data. You can spend your earned coins to get new moves and abilities on your specific in-game figures, but we found through playing that both the in-game and downloadable promo Pokémon are usually higher leveled. Overall, I still found Rumble U occasionally fun, but it was definitely a missed opportunity on a lot of levels. But is it the worst? Not quite. Another game that always bugged me was the Pokémon Dream Radar. It was a 3DS download app that was basically a slightly upgraded version of Face Raiders, the completely free augmented reality shooter that you get with every new Nintendo 3DS. The main idea was that you could use the Dream Radar to interact with Pokémon from your house, collect a few legendaries, and transfer them over to your copy of Black or White 2. It's extremely simple, but also $3, so I can't get too mad at it. What I do get mad at, though, is the $15 Pokédex 3D Pro, which didn't even update to include Generation 6 Pokémon after X and Y. Never buy it. But it isn't really a game, either. The next one isn't a terrible game by any means, but while digging deep to find some games for this video, I did find the worst Pokémon animation quality of all time. Ready for this one? Pokémon Play It! A DVD with Pokémon trading card game gameplay that was often packaged with other products. The game itself isn't bad at all, but just take a look at this.
Hey, my name is Julie. I'm a Pokémon trainer just like you. Stick with me, and together, we'll become the greatest Pokémon masters the world has ever seen.
How? Why was this ever a thing that was allowed to happen? But beyond these small Pokémon titles, there are three major Pokémon spin-off games that have gotten under my skin in the past. Pokémon Dash, Hey You Pikachu, and Pokémon Channel. And probably not by coincidence, all three of these titles, and the Pokémon Rumble franchise, come from the same video game developer, Umbrella. Pokémon Dash sounds decent on the surface. It's a Pokémon-themed racing game. You race from a top-down perspective, where everything is controlled by the stylus only. By constantly swiping in a single direction, your racer runs. The game's pretty ugly even for other DS titles at the time, but the gameplay is really what bothers me. Things are either way too simple and boring, or way too needlessly complicated. You race by touching checkpoints along the way. There's no lap system, so most stages have you running frantically in many directions. You can pick up power-ups that can help you run on certain terrain, but other than that, the earliest stages are just mindless swiping. Then, things get weird when the balloon is introduced. When you get a balloon power-up, you can rise hundreds of feet into the air. Once up there, though, you aren't given any specific directions on where the next checkpoint is, just a general picture on the map of what it will look like. The game then shifts to a weird Where's Waldo moment, where you try and match the checkpoint on the map below you. When you fall through, you have to consider how fast you fall. You pop balloons to fall faster, but different terrain has different softness based on how many balloons you popped, and you can't fall into forests at all. And often you aren't told when it's the optimal time to use a balloon, so some stages you'll be at a huge disadvantage if you either use it too late or use it too early. Oh! It's not that the balloon system being complicated is bad, but what it effectively does is force you to memorize stage patterns rather than employ any kind of on-the-fly skill. It's not the worst game I've ever played again, but it is tedious. At just 5 cups with 5 stages each, some even with overlapping layouts, it's just not very fulfilling of a full-price game. But if you dislike Pokémon Dash like I did, at least you can take it out on Pikachu. Super Mario 64 style. But maybe you like Pikachu. Maybe so much that you wish you could talk to him directly. Have no fear, because Hey You Pikachu is here! The game released in Japan for the Nintendo 64 in 1998, and the rest of the world 2 years later in 2000. The entire game is built around a novel idea for its time, voice control. By using a microphone that you plug into the fourth controller slot, you can play with your own personal Pikachu and give him voice commands. It's your goal to lead a stray Pikachu through a variety of minigames and leisurely activities, all by voice. There are a set number of commands that you can give Pikachu, many of which are revealed throughout the game. 10-year-old me was so excited at the idea of talking to Pikachu in-game, but it just isn't as complex as you'd think. He doesn't exactly understand complete phrases. He'll only work with simple commands. There. Fun fact! It's a common belief that Pikachu will get angry if you yell Sony, PlayStation, or Sega at him, but I found very quickly that this is just an urban legend. None of these commands exist within the game's voice data files. The more you know. PlayStation.
Pikachu.
Also, contrary to popular belief, the microphone's recognition system is spot on. If you say a specified command loud and clear, I found that the game recognizes it almost every single time. The microphone isn't the problem, it's the system. Heyu Pikachu's biggest flaw is that Pikachu is not a loyal pet. He has a mind of its own, and he'll go off and interact with the environment whenever you aren't talking to him. I just want to look for treasure, but no, he needs to jump around right now. Maybe you'll need him to get some food, but no, he's too busy twerking. It's dreadful in execution.
Watering can?
One of the biggest flaws is the way that they decided to handle camera progression. There are three groups of stages in the game. Over the first, you have to play the game with the camera focused on Pikachu at all times. It makes most minigames and item collecting extremely difficult because you can't move off from Pikachu to point out objects for him. Only in the second set of levels do you unlock the ability to walk freely away from Pikachu. And then in the third set, you unlock the ability to freely look around yourself. I get that the plan was to make the game more simple before giving you full control, but it makes the early segments just painful. It's hard enough controlling Pikachu when you do have the camera, and without it, the game often ends up with players quitting in frustration before they even beat the early stages. Yell at Pikachu when you want him to pull in a fish. Yell at Pikachu to herd Poliwag. Yell at Pikachu to feed Caterpie. Yell at Pikachu to find treasure. And then you yell at him based on what the game tells you to yell on the sign. There's a lot of yelling. When you're not doing missions, Pikachu likes to mess with your stuff. Come on, Pikachu, pick up after yourself. Oh, wow, he actually did. Perhaps the greatest example of how obnoxious Pikachu can be is the game's final mission. You have to track Pikachu through the wild while hiding in a cardboard box. You can't talk to Pikachu. You can't even get spotted by him. You just have to watch. He gets distracted by everything. Gotta eat again. Gotta say hi to him. And him. And him. What am I even doing right now? I'm playing a voice-controlled game, and I'm not even allowed to use my voice. It's just... But then, at the end of the game, and yes, there is an end to this thing, most people just give up before they get there, they throw you for the loop. Professor Oak tells you that you need to release Pikachu into the wild because he'd be happier that way. Are they seriously making me live the anime episode Pikachu's Goodbye? But that episode made people cry! And I know what you're thinking. After all I've been through with this guy, I should be happy he's leaving. But you know what? Throughout all the pain, he's now my responsibility. He's my mistake. You can't do this to me! You can't! And then the credits roll. Alright, so he doesn't really leave, but still. I will give Umbrella props. This jumbled mess of technology and programming actually got me to feel an emotion for a brief moment. Heyu Pikachu is a mess, but I'll openly admit it. It's not as bad as I remember it being. Its greatest shortcoming is the difficulty to audience ratio. It's a game meant for children, and I'm sure kids would love it. But controlling Pikachu is so hard that only an adult would fully understand the controls. But once you're an adult, the content is too simple to entertain. The solution to this, theoretically, comes with Pokémon Channel, the umbrella Pikachu-based game for the Nintendo GameCube. This game does away with complicated voice controls and instead gives you the silky smooth goodness that is the Nintendo GameCube controller. Pokémon Channel looks better than Heyu Pikachu. It controls better than Heyu Pikachu, but somehow it is even less of a video game than Heyu Pikachu. Your main goal is to watch TV. With Pikachu. I'm not kidding, half of this game is completely non-interactive. The main bulk is watching episodes of Pichu Bros, an anime special that plays like those Pikachu specials they play before the main movies, with talking Pokemon and no humans. Even moments when you can play the game, there's a lot of watching. Wanna do the quiz channel? You gotta wait 5 more times for the contestants to answer questions before you get to answer one yourself. Wanna shop? You gotta listen to Squirtle. Want the weather? Let me warn you, it's slow, bro. You do not want to watch the weather. Unlike Heyu Pikachu, this game is perfect for children. All you do is watch TV. But for the grown adult, good Arceus, is this game boring. This game literally forces you to count sheep. Like 50 of them, My favorite thing to do is actually outside of the TV, where different Pokemon quiz you on Pokedex info. I didn't make all those Pokedex videos for nothing! This is my dojo! Oh my god, is that a Hoppip? You complete the game once you've watched all 5 episodes of Pichu Bros. And what do you get as a reward once you're done? Jirachi, who projects all 5 episodes of Pichu Bros for you, again, on the night sky. There's actually a weird moment toward the end where you have to watch Meowth in 3D.
Mini fact of the day!
This segment is actually from the Space World 2000 Nintendo GameCube demo, before the GameCube even existed as a product. Meowth's actions are randomized every time it plays. We'll talk about Nintendo Space World in a future Fact of the Day episode. After that, you can unlock the ability to watch Pichu Bros. Again, this time with Misty as a narrator. Oh, just kidding. With Kasumi, the Japanese voice actress for Misty, as a narrator. That was unexpected. Possibly the greatest reason I hate this game, though, past the mind-numbingly boring television stations, is the version I grew up with. It turns out that in the European and Australian PAL versions of the game, you can download a free Jirachi after you beat it. It turns out that in the US, it only came for a bonus disc that was given to you for pre-ordering Pokemon Colosseum. But yeah, Pokemon Channel is cute and colorful, perfect for kids, and honestly, in the right mood, it's actually very relaxing. But is it a good video game? No, my god, is that a Hoppip TV? Actually, it makes the entire game impossible to see because the TV has the sky in it. Seriously, every channel is just blue with clouds.
While Pokemon games are both good and bad, you can at least say one thing about them. They're certainly unique. As always, this is a very opinion-based video. When you're talking about games that you like and don't like, there's no universal truths. So if you guys have some opinions that differ from mine, or maybe you're just the same, let me know in the comment section below what some of your least favorite Pokemon games are of all time. Once again, I want to thank Audible.com for being such an incredible sponsor of this show, helping me get you guys high-quality content for completely free. And once again, the Audible.com/TheJWittz code is back online. Books are cool, and so is reading, but you also have a limited amount of hours in the day, and who doesn't want to spend those extra hours doing things like breeding Pokemon? But what if, instead of having to read a book with physical words in front of you, all you had to do was listen to it with the narrator that has a much cooler voice than you? Well, you'd still breed Pokemon. That's the idea behind Audible.com, where you can listen to thousands of different audiobooks, the largest library in the world, over all of your different devices. If you're interested in reading a book while doing something else that's important in your life, you can head over to audible.com/TheJWittz to get a free audiobook, check out the system, and see if it's something you're interested in. This month, I recommend the first book in the Bartimaeus trilogy. This is one of my favorite trilogies that I ever read growing up. It's all about high fantasy. It's sort of like Pokemon, except with genies. Except if the Pokemon genies were also very, very sarcastic and didn't really obey. Like a Thundurus combined with Charizard. We'll go with that. It's an awesome book, and I hope you guys enjoy it. Until then, thank you guys for watching today's episode of Pokemon Fact of the Day, and I'll see you with the next video. If you want to see some Pokemon spin-off games that I actually did enjoy, you can click over here to check out my top 10 favorite Pokemon spin-off games. Also, my fiancé Renee over at Renee Collects has started a really cool new series where she's cross-stitching Pokemon sprites. She started with Ghastly for this month, so if you want to go ahead and check out her channel, I'm sure she would really appreciate it. If you enjoyed this video and would like to know when more are coming out, you can click this button right below me to subscribe to this channel and get alerts right when my new videos are coming out. Thank you guys for watching this video, and I'll see you guys with the next Nintendo Fact of the Day.